Welcome back to Insomnia True Silver Championship 2. My name is Nimsh, and this time I'm joined on the couch by Solo and Noxious.
Yes.
For the second match of the day. Swiss round 2 started already. Solo, were you on the ground like Noxious? Were you guys talking to the players? What was the energy? What was happening?
Yeah, I mean, everyone's super excited about Swiss. As always with Swiss, first round pairings come out and everyone's like, oh no, I've got this guy. Oh God, I've got the hard side of the bracket. But yeah, round one Swiss, you're going to have some rough matchups, and there definitely were some Clash of the Titans situations in round one, but that's always going to happen. I think overall, people are just generally really excited about Swiss. So.
Yeah, I mean, the tournament is stacked as a whole, so it's kind of hard to dodge every single top player. And we had Firebat versus Dog round one on the cast. Some people are probably screaming, oh no, this is rigged. They're just trying to stack the good players. But being that it is Swiss, it doesn't matter as much since players can just always come back from a tough position early. It's going to be tough, of course, if you lose the first two matches, given that your tiebreaker might be a bit lower than you like. But it's not impossible. So.
Yeah, absolutely. I think I talked to LifeCode just after this round, and he was counting that how many 5-2s actually make it to the top 16.
Right.
If you do 7-0, absolutely you're there.
Yeah.
6-1, absolutely you're there. Some 5-2s will actually make it. Did you guys make the count? Like, do you know how many 5-2s will actually
make it? I think it's 7 or 8.
Yeah.
Rough maths, I haven't done it. Like, I know there's like Swiss calculators and stuff that you can do online, but I think it'll be 7 or 8 that make it, something like that.
Yeah.
Casters aren't known for their math skills.
No, of course not.
So we definitely don't want to be 0-2, but even if you go 0-2, if you actually lose versus those great opponents like Firebat or Dog in those first rounds, the tiebreaker can actually carry you anyway.
Right. You just get that extra little bit of mileage out of your matches. But, I mean, talking to the players about the energy and whatnot, I feel like the players seemed, for the most part, pretty happy to play in the event, because I feel like for a Swiss tournament, with so many players, I rarely see that many players show up, right? That many pro players just kind of be there for a massive event where the odds of making it to the big money is, you know, the EV of a player being here is actually not as high as you might expect.
Yeah, absolutely. And what do you guys think about Last Hero Standing? Like, have you seen any specific decks? Like, in the first match, we've seen an interesting Zubil with Vigim Hunter. We've seen the Control Warrior from both players and the Druid with Sylvanas and Double Ancient of War. Was there anything specific you guys seen on the...
I mean, I was walking around a few of the pro player games, and there's a bit of a tendency towards rogue. It's not overall popular in the tournament if you look at all the lineups, but I think between the experienced players, they brought a lot of rogue. I think rogue's really well positioned, but Last Hero Standing, this kind of format, especially without a ban, just kind of leads you to want to bring sweep decks, right? You want to have three decks in your lineup that can 3-0 your opponent. Things like Freeze Mage and even things like Control Warrior, to me, are a little bit sketchier because you can snipe out one matchup with them, but then your opponent's just going to come back at you with, you know, Druid or, you know, Control Warrior to beat your Freeze Mage, for example. And you kind of just have this one-win deck situation, which is not really what you want in Last Hero Standing.
Yeah.
What about bringing decks that you can outplay people with? So you are, obviously, there's a lot of pro players in this tournament right now, but you will be facing a lot of local players, like a big field. So I've heard a story from some of the players that qualify online in the tournaments that they like to bring Freeze Mage in the early rounds or Control Warrior, because people don't know how to play against those decks.
I mean, I guess it's pretty tough to know how to play around them, because in the hands of a skilled player, those decks tend to do wonders. It's kind of like Rogue, actually, right?
Yes.
Like, a lot of players brought Rogue, but not everybody. It's the type of deck that you just don't feel comfortable playing if you don't know the class and the matchups inside out. And surprisingly, you know, a lot of the top pros have brought it. I know RDU is in favor of the deck. I think right now he thinks it's the single best deck you could have brought to this tournament.
Rogue.
Rogue, yep. Absolutely. And this just goes to show that, yes, there might be a certain metagame that you can try to outplay the opponents, but ultimately, like, it comes down to those sweep decks, and
right.
Rogue is one of those.
Yeah, it absolutely is. And I think there's also, like you said, you're playing against some more casual players, some inexperienced people who are just here for the event and playing some Hearthstone while they're here. So I think you can exploit the tendency for them to say, bring Secret Paladin, Druid, Zoo. You know, they're going to bring the simplistic curve out deck. So you can use things like Oil Rogue, for example, to...
Right. Yes.
Sorry,
nothing. It's true. It makes sense.
Yeah. And it's just sensible tournament strategy,
yes,
right? If you go into a tournament and don't think you're one of the best players, just play the decks that give you a chance of just drawing well and you know, clutching out wins. So it makes sense. But then if you're a really experienced pro player, you can evaluate that meta and then bring the decks that punish those lineups as well, which, again, Rogue is really well positioned to do. So.
Yeah, I do agree fully. And the next match we are going to see is Elky from Team Liquid versus Martin Creek from SK Gaming. And what do you guys think about this match and the lineups?
I mean, Martin Creek is a very, very experienced player, one of the SK team members who have just really started to establish themselves as one of the dominant teams in Europe. Obviously, we were casting together when AK won in Katowice. That was one of their big major wins for them. Obviously, Powder as well, very experienced player. So right. They have an incredible lineup. But Elky also impressed me with his game knowledge when we were casting in Katowice. He had some really strong analysis of the game. He's obviously a very talented person that picks things up and internalizes concepts very quickly. Because he had a really high-level understanding of the game, and you could see that come through in his casting. So I'm not going to count him out here either.
Yeah, and it's funny because you mentioned the whole bringing decks that you know are going to be easier to play against a field that you think maybe is a bit tougher. And Elky, I remember a while back at C-Story Cup, I think the last one, he brought easier decks from his perspective. And he said it, you know, openly. He said, I don't think I'm of the caliber that some of those other players are. And thus, I'll bring decks that I think are going to have a chance, even though I might mess up. And this is exactly the type of strategy that makes sense. Now, I don't know if that's the same strategy he's going to do now, since he's acquired quite a bit of experience since. But it is a he's a really down-to-earth player.
Well, we can see that he actually brought Druid, Paladin, and Warlock. So looking at those decks, you would think that this is the Secret Paladin,
right,
and a Midrange Druid.
I assume.
That would be the go-to. Yeah, there's some flexibility there. The Warlock can be Rena Lock, or I've also seen at least one player in this tournament is bringing Mali Lock because thinks it's really well positioned right now. So, but we are, looks like we're just about ready to get into game one here.
What do you guys think about the decks from Martin Creek? Like, he's bringing Shaman.
Shaman, yeah. I think, you know, Warrior, Shaman, Rogues were kind of the up and runners after the top three decks that you'd expect, which are Druid, Paladin, and Warlock, right? Those are kind of the three core classes, and the other follow-ups, I think, really are kind of to be expected. Martin Creek has two of those in his lineup with the obvious go-to Druid, so something, I'd say it's standard.
So if you look at those decks, and if you would have to select one deck that can 3-0, which deck would that be for both players?
I mean, it depends on lineups, and there's nothing really that sticks out. Shaman definitely has the potential with a good draw to beat any of these decks. I think it's slightly unfavored against Zoo and slightly unfavored against Secret Paladin, but it takes a lot of recognition from the opposing side of particular situations to be able to achieve that favorable win rate. So the Shaman can definitely do a lot of work from Martin Creek's side. But then if you look at the rest, you know, Warrior and Druid, you kind of expect to win one matchup either way and then get countered fairly effectively. But Druid, again, just has the ability to blow out a series if it draws well.
Right, and it doesn't really have any terrible matchups right now. If you want to beat Druid, you kind of have to tech all in against it, in which case, in here at Last Hero Standing, that's probably a very bad idea, given that you'll get stuck with that deck afterwards. So I don't think Druid will have any weakness to either of these lineups, so I wouldn't give any player a huge edge.
All right, so is it going to be Druid versus Druid clash, the 50-50?
It definitely could come down to that. I mean, I think it depends on who leads with what here. I think the Druids will probably both be kept back. I wouldn't expect either of them to lead out here. So it definitely could end up clashing that way, especially if, say, each player's counter deck for the Druid is eliminated. So from Martin Creek's perspective, if his Shaman is already gone and if Elky's Warlock is already gone, then the 50-50 matchup might just end up being the best thing.
That's right. And this is not only the clash of the players, it's also a clash of the teams. Like we've mentioned, Liquid and SK. I know the SK guys, they practice a lot together and they brought similar lineups, where Elky is definitely talking to both Dog, Nairia, and Savit with regards to...
So Martin Creek might be running a more aggressive list for Druid. So we're talking about the Flame Juggler list, running something like 6-2 drops, you know, Aspirants, Flame Jugglers, Druids of the Saber. So that's a very difficult matchup. I'd say against Zoo, it's slightly worse in some cases, assuming he's playing the aggro list. If you're not able to, slightly better, that is, than the regular Druid.
Better for the Druid player, right?
Right.
Yeah, better for
the Druid. Exactly, for the Druid player.
Yeah, yeah.
Because normally when you play versus Midrange Druid versus Zoo, you need to hit those innervates and be able to get the Keeper of the Grove to just get the board under control. But here you might have like Knife Juggler, Flame Juggler. You have those minions that are early game to fight for the board. And then, Warlock deals damage to itself with the hero power. And as this kind of Druid, you want the opponent to be damaged as much as possible.
Well, looks like the Shade. I want to say the Shade and the Drake make me think it's maybe less of that aggro Druid.
Right. I mean,
it's a bit polarized.
Yeah, he might have just inserted Flame Juggler into a more mid-range Druid list just as an anti-aggro tool, just to give him more insurance against decks like Face Shaman, like Zoo, like Secret Paladin, etc. It's interesting because you know, way back in the day, mid-range Druid did used to classically play a 2-drop.
That
it
is
was true. Something, something like Sun Fury Protector, Power of the Wild you'd see in there. So,
what if he wanted to play double Aspirant, but he didn't have a second copy? He could. he bought a couple of packs.
Well, that, I mean, if that's the
not.
Case,
I guess not.
Yeah, then he didn't have either Aspirin.
Oh.
Decided to put, oh, this is a 2-3. Like,
I opened
thing.
The worst card packs ever.
And nobody wanted to trade me cards before the event.
Oh, no. Poor little Martin Creek. I think I'll do just fine, though, a double juggler against the Zoo deck. You've got to be happy to find those. I guess, like, typically you'll be happy to find them later when, you know, the implosions popped and you're guaranteed at least higher likelihood of hitting something. Whereas here it's a little clunky. But it is a 2-3 to contest that juggler nicely.
Right, and Elky's hand is looking a little bit clunky itself. It, you know, the Power Overwhelmings will be very useful at some point against Druid, but it's not the incredible pressure that you want to have early of like the dream curve curving out all the way with minions. So it's going to need a little bit of help. IMB Cow not getting anything done right now, so just the Flame Imp in terms to play for initiative this turn.
Yeah, I like the ping of the juggler, though. It basically guarantees that he doesn't have to unstealth his Shade and still gets a kill on either of these minions, possibly two if Elky gives him value.
But. Yeah, it was quite fortunate there, but so what do you guys think about Elky's deck overall? We've seen Bram Bronzebeard, so is it the Dark Iron version or is it the Sea Giant version?
I mean...
Can you still play Bram Bronzebeard, the Sea Giant version?
You can, yeah. It is used now and then. You still have things like Gormok, Defender of Argus, Abusive Sergeant, etc. There's enough Battlecries in the deck, and also you lose Doomguard, one of the negative synergies with Bran. But I think it's more commonly seen in the faster list, the list that just tops out at Doomguard, but
yeah.
We haven't really seen too many absolutely identifying cards from this deck yet.
Yeah.
So that juggler again, finds a target. This means that Martin Creek not only has the board, but also manages to clear his opponents. Elky will probably have to hope he picks up something like a Coil off of Peddler if he wants to deal with the board like this in the next few turns.
Yeah, absolutely. I think those decks have something in common, and this is that it's really hard to come back if you are behind. Both Zoo and Druid, they don't have that many clears. Like, Zoo actually doesn't have any clears. Only Implosion is something to deal with a bad board state. But right now, there's no Implosion for Elky.
Yeah, it's interesting that you mentioned Implosion because he chose to reveal the Shade there on like one of the few turns that it could be removed from hand on curve.
Right.
But in that situation, he's not at all bothered if his Shade gets Implosioned. He still has those two minions consolidated on board, and he has a 2-drop plus hero power to follow up. So the expected result of an Implosion for his opponent there is actually pretty solid for Martin Creek. So I love the decision to just go ahead and reveal the Shade there.
So apparently, Young Priest and Blood Imp just want to buff everything, and South Sea Deckhand just showing up for the party for nothing.
Mm-hmm.
This is a pretty bad pickup for Elky, because both these are weak to... Well, every single minion there is either weak to Swipe or Hero Power.
Yeah, they're just bad.
It's just bad. It's just bad cards.
Yeah. Does take the Young Priestess. Seems like the best pick. Obviously, strictly better than the South Sea Deckhand in this situation, but he's going to go ahead and Life Tap, recognizing that he does need some help in his hand right now, but I'm not sure about this because... Sure, you can look for better cards to answer the situation, but if Druid just keeps building a board here, what cards are even in your deck that answer the
Demon
situation?
Wrath!
No, yeah, sure.
It's one of those rare cases where somehow you wish that were in your deck.
Well, people played a one of Shadow Flame at some point.
I remember that. Yes, that's right.
But we have three different Zoo lists, and neither runs AoE cards.
So this Shade will have to be neutralized with the Iron Beak Owl. I think Elky is considering it. It's not as though the options are too many, honestly.
It's actually pretty devastating for Elky overall because this game already is super hard, but to begin with, I think that was a good matchup for Elky. Like, at least slightly. Those jugglers definitely improved the matchup for the Druid, and the fact how Martin Krieg is getting those, low-cost cards to be able to fight back. But Elky was probably, when he queued Warlock versus Druid, he thought, like, I've got this. This is my good matchup.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think he would have been expecting the mid-range Druid and really been happy when he saw the matchups line up, unless he scouted some information from Martin Creek's round one opponent. But the aggro Druid definitely does have the tools to fight a lot better. As Noxious said, those increased number of 2-drops in the deck, just the flame jugglers in this case, have just made such a big deal. And even though this does seem to have curved out into a much more standard mid-range Druid, you've seen how much work those flame jugglers have got done. They're still on the board right now after being played in the early turns.
And they are going nowhere because Force of Nature looks definitely juicy in this situation, just trading the board. One of the best uses, like you sometimes think about Force of Nature as a burst card, just go for face, but if you can actually just deal with three cards using only one card, it's such good value.
Yeah, and this is kind of why Force of Nature, this is probably the intended use of Force of Nature, I want to say, of the card by Blizzard. It turned out to be a monstrosity. We made it a monstrosity.
Someone did. Someone somewhere along the line went, hey, you know what's good? Yeah. You combine this with Savage Roar.
Oh, damn. Thank you. Thank you, Close Beta. So Druid doing his thing. And I want to say here, Martin Creek is going to be able to replay that Druid. And that is really important because this being last hero standing means it's not quite over for Elky nightmare-wise. There's still a lot of innervates to dodge.
Yeah, and the thing is, like, for last hero standing as opposed to Conquest, you do have counter decks.
Right.
You prepare a lineup in a way to kill Druid in the process, but Zoo was one of the decks, I believe, to counter the Druid. So now, what is left for Elky? He still has a Paladin, and he still has a...
His own Druid. So you could do Druid things to the other Druid. That might help.
So 50-50, possibly.
Right. I mean, I'm interested as to how the addition of the Flame Jugglers will change that matchup, because... And the SK people definitely have some interesting twists on their decks. I heard them talking about Aggro Shaman earlier, a conversation you were involved in as well, Noxious, and don't want to give away, but they have an interesting build of the Face Shaman deck in the SK camp as well. So love seeing these little twists. And there is a Druid of the Saber in this deck. So, very interesting build. And a piloted Sky Golem. Wow.
Okay, this is something normally don't
see. SK have managed to make Druid interesting.
Yeah, I really like the Sky Golem here. In fact, this is the type of minion that you would only include in a deck like this to make it less, like, more resilient against AoE. So if there were, say, Mounted Raptor in the list as well, you will tend to see aggro druids go along that line. The Shade is not something I see as a two of in a list like this. Maybe a one of with two other three drops makes a lot of sense.
I wonder if they even play Fellreaver, because in the current metagame, like you said, Noxious, that Rogue is one of the biggest players in the room, especially when they play Last Hero Standing. So then maybe you do cut the Fellreaver to bring Pilot Sky Golem instead.
Yeah, I mean, it's possible, it makes a lot of sense, but I mean, this deck just seems kind of halfway house, right, between the aggro deck and the mid-range deck. They have the Drakes, I would assume that Laws are in here as well, so it's kind of just classic mid-range Druid with some extra insurance of, you know, solid curve minions early on, so really interesting build from Martin Creek, and I would presume, because of how heavily they practice together, that the rest of the SK guys have brought a similar deck as well if they do have Druid.
Yeah, it would make sense.
Yeah, and this is actually great because a lot of people say that metagame is stale because we expansion's coming in, what, like 1 month or 2 months?
Yeah.
Forever. In forever.
In soon TM.
Yeah.
But we see new decks all the time. Like the first run we've seen, not exactly new, but people add those specific twists.
Yeah.
And trying to evolve the metagame even more, even though like we knew the cards.
Yeah, I think the nooks and crannies of deck building is what's left after so long of, you know, I guess the metagame being quote-unquote figured out. And you'll tend to see, you know, little twists on a very solid core, which is pretty much what we're looking at.
So he played a second mini-bot that turn along with a secret, and he chose to go with the Noble Sacrifice this turn instead of the Competitive Spirit. How do you feel about that, Noxious?
Yeah, I was actually wondering, because I guess it plays around the hero power popping a shield a lot better. The only thing you're not playing around is something like Keeper of the Grove, but does it matter? No. So ultimately, this forces the Druid to have an innervate if he wants to do anything to your board, and that on its own is it's valuable, right? You're protecting very nicely to follow it up with good sticky minions.
I just feel like getting the Competitive Spirit gives you such a good chance of a 2/3/3s there, and especially with your opponent's expected play being Piloted Shredder, a couple of Divine Shielded 3/3s on the board would have been pretty insane that turn.
So a coin plus Competitive Spirit curving into, like, let's say Keeper of Uldemon would have been...
Sure. I mean, I'm just saying, you could have played Competitive Spirit instead of the Noble Sack, right, and kept your coin for the potential curve. So definitely a consideration anyway.
Yeah, definitely a consideration, but I think it still works for him because right now he gets the Keeper, so he buffs the minions still to a 3/3, has an okay trade.
If kind of Competitive Spirit, right?
Yeah.
Anyway, well, the Toad comes down, so this means Noble Sacrifice will still work, and we see that Competitive Spirit coming down.
That is dangerous for Martin Creek.
Yeah. Another thing I want to talk about, by the way, is like bringing a deck that's different than what people expect in the Swiss format. I think it's really good because people do not expect those decks. They have not played around those cards, and they're super confused. Like, if you face your opponent, let's say, round 3, it's a very important round for you, mm-hmm. and they slam Flame Juggler, what is going through your head?
Right. Yeah, I mean, it makes a lot of sense. It's definitely something to be said to, you know, surprising the meta, getting outside the meta, operating on a different thing, because, as you said, everyone's perception of the game right now is that it's really stale. So when they look at your lineup of Druid, Warlock, Paladin, whatever, everyone's going to make a snap judgment as to what you're playing,
yeah.
and then make their pick decisions, their pick order based on, you know, faulty information if you brought more interesting stuff. The counter argument to that is that the meta is, quote, stale because those decks are just the best decks.
They're the best decks, yeah. And you have to try to twist your own decks around to make yours works against that. So I don't know, I feel like there is, again, room for innovation on the small scale.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so let's see what's happening here.
It's dangerous. LK picked up the competitive spirit full value. The Noble Sacrifice still not triggered, so LK gets to trade with this Drake. Doesn't even need to summon champion. Develops probably the Belcher, being that it's such a big roadblock for Druids.
Yeah, and even if he wants to, like, if Mindred Creek wants to attack with the Shade to kill the Belcher, he'll have to Hero Power, so use 2 mana next turn, making it only 4 available to him.
I mean, technically, I guess you could use that Force of Nature, right?
Right.
It would let you pop the Slime. I mean, your Shade would be at 2 health left.
Yeah.
And then you're forcing awkward trades from the... I mean, it's kind of tough. I don't dislike the Flame Juggler with a Living Roots, depending on where it hits.
I feel like just jamming Piloted Sky Golem this turn is perfectly fine.
You're
as
right,
well.
Actually. That does make sense.
Because, like, the Force of Nature play is fine. It's just the problem with it is what do you do with that third tree, right? So one of them pops the Noble Sack. The second one clears out the Slime after the Shade attack. But then the third one just doesn't achieve anything. So I feel like just getting another sticky minion on board to increase your options for how to ration out attacks with Force of Nature and Living Roots on the following turn.
I think it gives you a bit more flexibility.
Like yeah, also, you do not expect that much burst from Paladin anyway, but there is this Iron Beak Owl for Elky that can easily counter the 6-4 and just continue doing damage.
This Shielded Minibot has been very effective.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, look at this damage. Like, 10 damage being pushed. Druid is supposed to be trying to win at this point, like setting up their own board to push you back with a combo play very soon.
By the way, the decision there to not Iron Beak Owl means that he just rushes and he will use Iron Beak Owl for a possible taunt.
Right.
Maybe next turn. We've seen double Ancient of War being played in the first match, so a good decision there to change the strategy instead of going for trades and stable board, just recognizes that, hey, this is the moment where I can actually push damage.
Yeah, what's Druid gonna do? Like, swipe, innervate, swipe? Like a Living Roots, what is that play? There's almost nothing the Druid can do to come back from a position like this, so if you see that opportunity, I think you just take it.
Yeah, that's one of the things with Secret Paladin is you really have to find the right time to make your push, because the deck is aggressive, but it doesn't play damage from hand, so if you start pushing too early and then get your board removed, then suddenly you're just behind the game for the rest of the game because you don't have that finisher from hand that a lot of aggro decks do. But I think Elky's timed it pretty well here. Looks like he's in a comfortable position to be able to push this through, even though there is a heavy removal turn here coming out from Mind Creek.
All right, so that's not quite enough for the lethal. That is a pretty good card to find here.
Yeah,
gives you a pretty good trade.
It does indeed. Owl on the Piloted Sky Golem, Consecrate, and trade your 1-1. You just have a Shredder on board, threatening lethal on the following turn. Or not quite threatening lethal.
Close enough, though.
Close
enough. And that is the play that he very quickly recognizes, smashes the Shredder interface, and with the Owl on board as well, actually, he is threatening lethal.
Yeah, he is actually threatening lethal.
This is a great position.
Wipe would be an insane pickup for Martin Creek with that Keeper of the Grove, but he doesn't find it. Instead, finds another 2-drop to stack on top of what he's already got. This is possibly a turn where you play Keeper of the Grove, the Charger, and the 2-1, the 2-3 to hit something for 1 at random.
Do you juggle first? Like, play Juggler first, see what it lands?
Right, because if the Juggler hits the Shredder, then you can silence and trade the Druid of the Charge into it. So it definitely seems like a reasonable line, but he might even consider just Ancient of Loring himself
the
face.
I like that a lot.
Does it solve anything, though?
Yeah, it kind of does.
It gets a 5-5 onto the board, which is kind of a big deal right now. You can't just continue to play from behind, because Paladin's just going to keep dropping stuff. So you need to get something competitive into play here. So I don't mind the heal at all.
Yeah. As competitive as 2 Shredders, or not quite? That's the question.
I think the problem with Ancient of Lore this turn is that it is it does save you, and it does create a 5-5. But there's still a board, and like you just lose this health.
Yep.
And now you're in a similar position, even in the worse position than you were last turn. Where with the Keeper of the Grove and Juggler, you have 2 minions and possibly deal with at least 1 of the opposing minions.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. I think from his position, he was just trying to get the 5-5 into play so he could make this same play from possibly a stronger position on the next turn. Didn't work out that way because Elky had such a powerful board to take initiative afterwards. So
I think you have to Hail Mary this. This is, from my perspective, this looks like a Hail Mary turn.
You're just going for the gusto, jam the shredder,
pray for
Doomsayer.
I can't even think of anything else at this point. Yeah. Oh, hi. That's not quite it.
Nope.
All right. Work out
well, I think he was also possibly thinking about Tyrion being played on 8.
Right.
Then
that's right.
The keeper.
Makes sense.
It wouldn't help that much because he'll be at 4, but yeah.
It was pretty dead.
Versus Paladin, you want to keep it. All right, so 1-1, and this means that Druid is dead for Martin Creek. Elky still has a Druid. Is Druid the strongest deck right now?
I think it's the deck with the least bad matchup.
Right.
And plus, there's a few decks that it does also blow out as well, so it has massively good matchups, but even its bad matchups, you're talking like 47%, 46%, something like that. You know, there's no, like, this deck absolutely just stomps all over Druid. It used to be Zoo back in the day, but now with Living Roots and Aspirant, if you're playing that, on top of the potential Innovate Keeper of the Grove draws and stuff like that, they can even fight in those matchups as well. So it's just consistent. It just has a solid 45 to 55% win rate across the board. And if it draws well and you're good at the deck, you're in a great position.
All right, so the War is being brought out by Martin Creek here. Gets himself the Paladin matchup, which is one, if he's got enough AoE effects, that is going to be pretty good. We have to know whether or not this is Control or Patron, though.
Yeah, this will definitely change.
But it looks like Control.
It does look like Control Warrior based on that Shield Slam. This is a matchup that Warrior used to struggle in early on, but when the more removal-based build came up with Double Revenge, etc., Double Brawl, Double Revenge, all those board sweeps actually give it a much better chance against these early minion-heavy decks. So they're in a decent position now as the Warrior to be able to win this matchup.
Yeah, definitely. I think it's an interesting one. Like you would think that if Paladin curves out with like Secret Keeper, Hunter Creeper, and like just follow up with minions, Warrior at some point will run out of cards. But so does Paladin, and if they go head-to-head, Warrior will have just a bigger minion in the end.
Right.
Unless we actually go from Mistress Challenger into Dr. Boom into Tyrion. But if not, the Paladin can struggle.
So we see the Harrison Jones from Martin Creek here in the Control Warrior, I imagine. It looks to me like that card in the matchup, even though it doesn't always do a lot of work, just the fact that you can mitigate that Tresor Champion's second hit, and which would have killed the Harrison Jones in many cases, is more valuable than the card draw itself.
Yeah, definitely. This is like also a good answer to Ashbringer if Tyrion dies.
Yeah, okay.
Or like
that is true.
Master for Battle possibly if you need more card draw.
Yeah.
Because it feels like you were forced to maybe execute something like a Knife Juggler and you just threw away your removal. Then Harrison Jones can like get you back in the game.
Yeah, the Harrison and Tyrion interaction is super important because, as I said in the previous game, Paladin doesn't really have damage from hand. So once Warrior gets control, they can just life gain out of the matchup. So one of the things that can stop them doing that is Ashbringer, because generally, Control Warrior doesn't play a transform effect or a silence, so having that Harrison as an option to remove 15 damage, essentially heal for 15, basically, is just a crazy effect.
Yeah. Now, Martin Creek must be a little worried here because he saw a Secret turn one with nothing but Death Rattles following it up. So he might be thinking, well, this could be redemption, and if it is, then I have to choose my target very cautiously.
Oh, definitely, but...
Ouch.
Well,
ooh, that's rough.
It comes back with one health, I guess, right? That is the upside.
Yeah, but then it will create another minion.
I mean, you kind of are fine. That is
Wow.
a bit awkward.
That mana wraith, though.
That mana wraith. Oh, goodness.
Well, then.
Yeah, this turn got kind of interesting.
Yeah.
Keeper of Voldemar this turn would have been so
insane.
Disgusting
yes.
for Elky. Instead, he's just going to have to go and play the Knife Juggler here just to try and get some initiative on the board. Couple of one health minions in play. There's the spiders that are inside that creeper and the thing on the shredder. So although it looks like he has an incredible board right now, once that Deathspite swing comes down, it's not looking so good. So I feel like he does have to commit something else to the board here.
Especially with
I wouldn't mind hero powering and just letting the warrior's weapon go off. Because ultimately you do keep that mana wraith and whatever is inside the shredder at the end of that sequence.
Well, Revenge can clear this board, I believe, if you attack into...
Yes, depends what Shredder brings out.
Yeah, yeah.
The Bash should take care of that.
Revenge is so good, though. Like, at the very beginning when it got released, we weren't sure because there was Whirlwind. But right now, those decks, like Paladin, let's say, you can get Warrior easy to 12.
Yep.
And you just need to like push and win the game. Like, if you don't, like Revenge is, as you mentioned, so a third brawl or like a fourth brawl as well.
I think early on as well, people underestimated how easy it was going to be to stabilize from low health with Control Warrior after Justicar was released.
True.
You know, it's totally reasonable to get down to 5-6 health now, sweep the board with a Revenge, and then because of the Justicar hero power, that's your point to just swing and start gaining 4 a turn. So I think people thought, like, if you were far enough behind to need the 3 Revenge, then you were probably losing anyway.
Yeah, but yeah.
They didn't combine it with Justicar mentally until we saw the effect that
right.
combination has.
And I think it's even funnier to think about the fact that when Justicar was initially played, you had Shield Maiden being phased out,
right?
Whereas right now it's being, you know, brought back in as a 2 of in all those Control Warrior decks. So it's basically adding way too much armor gear.
We also have Bash. And,
right.
Is there any card being played that, because we play at least Star Seeker,
mm-hmm.
If you have too much removal, at least can actually change your cards into legendary cards.
Yep.
Does at least make some cards playable that you would normally not play the card because it's useless endgame, but because you play at least Star Seeker, you can always change into something?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
It's a problem that like heavy control decks run into, I think, where you can build a control deck to beat aggro, or you can build a control deck to beat control. And Elise is just such a fantastic card for kind of just filling, like crossing that bridge for you, so you can turn all these cards that you don't really need in control matchups into just high value threats. So
yeah.
You're so far ahead in the endgame.
Okay, Gorehal showed up.
Oh, hello.
That's gonna be pretty useful. Given all the small minions in that deck.
Versus Paladin, definitely.
And I like how the Mana Wraith is preventing a potential challenger coming out on the board. Assuming Elky were holding it, Martin Creek is like, you know what, you can just keep that Mana Wraith. It'll buy me time until I can get that Gorehal out and play from there pretty safely.
It's not buffing Mana Wraith, no!
Execute!
Mind Creek's just sat looking across the table right now like, ah, look at this guy. Probably has the Paladin God Drawer in his hand and he just can't play it all on curve because of that Mana Wraith.
Not quite.
Yeah, right.
Not quite.
No.
Hashtag protect the Mana Wraith.
Yeah.
Okay.
This is great, though. Like, this Mana Wraith, usually you don't see Mana Wraith coming in play as being a big factor in the way a game plays out for so long. Very often it will matter for a turn or two, and then people get rid of it somehow. But there's nothing to trade it into here.
Do you slam Gorehal? It's a Paladin, after all. Like, you will take 5 gold down to 13, and there's 3 damage. But then you do have Execute, you have Big Game Hunter. Mana Wraith is still there as a card.
What about Shield Maiden? Is putting down a Shield Maiden simply not worth it?
I really like the Gorehal here because it pushes you into revenge range, you know, after you've used the Gorehal and taken the attacks.
Okay.
And then you can start to use Shield Maiden, etc., to build yourself back up after that once you've activated that revenge in your hand. So I'm actually really surprised to see Shield Maiden come down here.
I think it's for the potential Gorehal plus Execute turn that could be coming out on 8, where you're weaving in that bit of extra mana, but you make a good point, yeah. It's kind of unusual not to see Gorehal come out as early as possible.
Right.
Also, maybe he felt like if he goes for Gorehal this turn, he takes the damage, and then Mistress Challenger is being played, and Gorehal is being blocked by Noble Sacrifice.
That's a really good point, actually. Yeah, I take that.
That's where the BGH comes in.
But yeah, normally.
Usually.
Yeah, it's hard to consider one of these players kind of considering that Mysterious Challenger comes down on curve on turn 7. It's just it's a weird
situation.
Like,
I've never thought about this.
Yeah. But, you know, it's one of the things, you know, although a lot of us will be happy to see Piloted Shredder go, it's one of the things I will miss as a caster. It creates, like, interesting situations that you don't get to see every day, and Mana Wraith is definitely one of those cards that's fun and entertaining when it does come.
Or Walker Cho beats it.
Right.
I have to admit, I don't think I've ever had as much fun casting, and probably playing, as when I have Lord Walker Cho on the board.
Dexter, can you take us through the last turn? What happened?
The last turn was a devastating, I've got the beast in my sights, because the Avenge landed on the only target it didn't have to. Well, there were 2 of them, so
50-50.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah. But it ended really well for Martin Creek.
Could have been a disaster.
And slowly, Elky is running out of damage. There is still a lot of health to go through. No card draw for Elky.
Yeah, and having now waited to play these Mustafa battles for so long, which, by the way, I don't think is any fault of his, because there was a Deathbite equipped on like the natural turn to play Mustafa battle, but having held onto it for so long, he's now going to give the Warrior such a potential blowout turn with Harrison Jones here.
Yeah, and with that revenge as well. I mean, the trade, the revenge, the Harrison Jones, Martin Creek basically has a dream turn. And if that wasn't enough, and, you know, he needed an additional answer.
For the future.
Why not?
I mean, having just drawn that Brawl, he might even feel like, hey, I have everything I need in hand right now. Maybe the only way I lose this game is to Tyrion and just hold on to the Harrison Jones for that consideration. But
I like
the temptation to draw 3 here is definitely pretty drastic.
What's an alternative? also like Brawl Revenge, like what will be better versus, let's say, Dr. Boom? Like he still has Execute for Dr. Boom passively.
So you would
right?
keep that Revenge then, I guess.
Yeah. So like you might
You could play Belcher trade with a 3-4 and let the Belcher deal with the board. I mean, Revenge Belcher is also pretty good. Lets you armor up on top of it, and you keep the 4-1. A little bit weaker, obviously, against some of the later plays. If there's an Owl or Consecration.
I'm just going to go ahead and Harrison. Like I said, three cards here just gives you so much play for the following turns. Deathlord and Grom both picked up here. Grom actually pretty useful as a removal tool now in Control Warrior, which is strange. It was
I remember
so
the
long. Just say, okay, you just never saw Grom until you died, and now it's just really commonly used as this source of 4 damage on the board in the late game turns.
Right. How long until we see King Crush being used the same way? Control
Ice,
Hunter.
Icefall, actually a card.
Right.
That's right. Yeah. I guess I'd use Icefall as removal prior to...
The new Hunter Epic, right? The Charging Worm thing?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Same thing, yeah. Giant, not charge, but like the repetitive attack. Giant Sandworm. Thank you, Noxious. I knew I could count on you.
I know.
To know card names.
Yeah. I just want Best of Wrath to see play with that.
Right.
No, that's the one thing I want.
It's a board clear in like 10 to face, right?
Noxious definitely had like a 15-minute video reviewing with that one card.
I loved it so much. But I guess I do get excited about all the cards, even the bad ones.
Right.
That's what I do.
Yeah. And this is your niche, Noxious. You can see the value in these terrible
cards. Yeah. No, they're terrible. They're legitimately terrible.
Yeah.
They're still fun, though.
Yes, they are. I'll give them that. I'll give them that. So a little bit awkward again for Elky. As we talked about, no burst, and the warrior stabilized. Not even low on health at all either, right? Like, didn't need that revenge for 3 damage. Just very comfortable sitting at 19 with more than enough removal.
So we got information that RDU won 3-1 versus Anakin from Dignitas?
Yes, Anakin is
Dignitas.
Dignitas,
yes. Yeah, I think he was a little bit stressed out before I talked to him a little bit. RDU, on the other hand, very confident as usual.
Yeah.
His lineup was the best.
Right.
Everybody's lineup was probably not the best. That's RDU.
Makes sense. I mean, he's here as the defending champion, right? So he's
Absolutely.
Right to show some confidence. If he can win a back-to-back, you know, huge event like this, then that's a massive achievement.
But to be honest, like, the best year for RDU was in the era of Last Hero Standing. Like,
yes, he
was always
absolutely.
Said to be the best lineup builder at the time.
I'd say, like, that general deck-building skill has stood the test of time. It's just that it's less impactful in the format of Conquest than he likes.
Solo is counting damage here.
Yeah, I was just looking at whether maybe Martin Creek was making a play here to set up Gromash Lethal, but he doesn't have the activator in hand right now, and without any armor, he can't use Shield Slam to do it. So he's just making a play for the board right now, realizes he's in a stable enough position. This is kind of the lowest risk turn he's had to develop that Gore Howl, because there's very little pressure on board, and he develops a Deathlord to protect himself. So he's just making the play now, going to get the long-term value out of that Gore Howl, and he has plenty of gas left in his hand, both proactively and reactively right now.
Noxious, what do you think about Deathlord and Warrior?
I think it's one of those cards that it used to be considered only for those really, really heavy fatigue warrior lists. You know, people used to toy around with Bouncing Blade with every single possible control tool, but it did make its way into the new control list. We saw Amnesia, I think, play that. Deathlord just being a solid, just a big defense against the Zoo decks and the Paladin decks that usually otherwise run you over.
Was Fibonacci also playing Deathlord?
I think Fibonacci was playing
Deathlord. Fibonacci was playing Deathlord.
With Deathwing.
With Deathwing.
Yes.
Yeah.
Very, very obvious combination, right?
So 7 damage in play, 8 with the weapon right now. The Sylvanas draw is interesting, because when you have Sylvanas and Brawl in the same hand, you almost feel obligated to play Sylvanas first.
Yeah.
Just see if they want to deal with it, and if not, you get the huge Brawl punish. But a little bit of a scary situation right now to just not react to this board right now and can continue to take damage, especially not having any life gain in hand, although you do have the Belcher at least.
Right. Do you like think Grom. You'd play Grom, since you've seen two Keepers of Uldemon?
Yep.
Right?
Yeah, Grom makes a lot of sense.
Kind of liking this. Warrior is just the class that's been, ever since Control Warrior became a thing after Naxxramas, I want to say, when it became really powerful.
Right.
The class has always been around. Okay.
Was this because Grom killed Iron Big Owl? Is it
ironic?
No, in a way, like the early bird catches the Grom.
What? And oh God.
Like
I don't even.
Yeah, Nimsh.
Sometimes I even, but this time I don't even, Nimsh. I can't do this.
There is such a lack of even right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, the amount of evens in this cast.
All right, but still, Grommash is hanging out.
More importantly, Tyrion Fordring
does come out. One of the last bastions of victory for Elky. If anything's gonna do it, it's gonna be this guy, I think. And even then, I mean, just look at this brawl.
Right.
Do you brawl this for sure?
Maybe. Oh, 29 for sure. I mean, you could.
Well, there might be just a way to deal with this Tyrion.
Do enlighten me.
Well, basically, you could just.
Belcher. I like Belcher.
As well.
I like Belcher.
Armor up Slum, execute Belcher, go face.
Right, I don't actually hate that either.
Yeah, that's good.
Like, you know, you're the one. You have removal in hand and you have a 10-7 on the board right now. So, brawling kind of feels like giving away a bit of initiative now with that Grommash in play. So, I think if you can deal with this, maintain your Grom, and then hide it behind a Sludge Belcher, that's a really powerful turn right
Also,
here.
Set up Lethal.
Lethal as well.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah, so, like, Brawl looks juicy overall, but. And especially because you also have two in hand. Mm-hmm. So what's the order, though? You just basically armor up, shield slam the shield. You attack the 2-6 into the 6-6. You execute Tyrion. You slam face with 10 damage. And you kill one of the 1-1s and still play
Belcher. That is left over, yeah.
Looks like he is going to go ahead and just double trade here, holding on to the executes and the shield slams. Going to continue to fight for the board, but
he hasn't seen Challenger, right?
No challengers and no Dr. Booms.
Yeah, not in this game. So yeah, I mean, it makes a lot of sense, but now that Consecrate in Elky's hand is going to get a lot of work done this.
Oh goodness.
Wow. Yeah.
Okay.
Nice Lothar to follow up. There are not that many 5-drops in the Paladin deck, but the ones that they are quite good.
That is very scary. Actually, this might just.
That might just lose the game, right?
Yeah, this feels like a really insane insane turn.
He was really close to winning if he would go for the removal play. Just setting up
right.
People.
And
Deathspite just not going to get the job done here.
You just brawl for 10 and hope the Lothab doesn't survive.
Oh,
you
like that to the weapon.
Die to weapon, okay.
So
well.
Armor up, shield slam is going to kill a 1-1. And then you're still dead.
We're nearly there. We found out how to.
Yeah, exactly. We can do this.
Wow.
I really like the Brawl last turn, and I think this is basically.
It's so crazy because he almost had the game. Like, if you make a different decision last turn, he just had it. But.
Yeah, I mean, even going back to the usage of Harrison Jones, I said at the time, perhaps
that's right.
The only way to lose this game at this point is to Tyrion. I mean, I probably would have played Harrison that turn as well. I think it was probably correct, but just goes to show sometimes the situations in games come out in ways where you can make the most consistent play overall, and it's the one that ends up losing you the game. It's
yeah.
One of those quirks of Hearthstone in general.
Yeah. And talking about consistency, like, Elky was super consistent this game. Just
I liked it, yeah. Very. He had a game plan and followed it through.
Yeah, he had to navigate all those Mana Wraith turns in the early turns as well. Which, I mean, yeah, we laugh, but it wasn't easy, right? It really messed up his natural plan. When you keep a curve of cards early and then suddenly a Mana Wraith ruins it all, you do have to, you know, have an added layer of thought to how you're going to get out of that situation. And with Mindcreep just deliberately leaving it alive the whole time as well, so yeah.
Yeah, like even top four, like we're laughing that it's a bad turn for him. Like he did just create a 1-1 instead of playing Juggler, so he never overextended. He just kept enough pressure on board to be consistent.
Yeah. So it looks like the Aggro Shaman from Martin Creek is going to be coming out. Now, Aggro Shaman was, I want to say, built to just eat up Secret Paladin. Initially, that is what its intended purpose was, and it did it very well. And with a hand like this, I think it'll keep doing it well.
Yeah, I mean, Flame Juggler in the deck, as you said, natural counter to Secret Paladin. One of the reasons you play this card in the deck is because it's one of the few 2-drops in the game that interacts favorably with Shielded Minibot.
Right.
Brackets 50% of the time.
that is unfortunate, but I mean, it still ends up trading 1-1 at the very least.
Right.
I mean, it's better than losing a Totem Golem to it,
yes,
right?
Yes, exactly.
Since they're both going to trade.
Yeah.
Firebot butchered.
Butchered?
Butcher.
Mm-hmm.
What did he do?
Butcher?
So,
Shielded Minibot. It seems like this is the second turn for Elky. He has Redemption already in play.
Right.
Shielded Minibot looks good here. And Martin Creek, he coined the Juggler.
Okay. So with one more mana, if the second Flame Juggler hit properly, that Redemption would fall to pieces.
He's still good, I think. Like, you just open, but what play though? Like, do you play Totem Golem or the Flame Juggler here?
Yeah, I mean, it's difficult. Flame Juggler definitely, from Mindcreek's perspective, will look fantastic if this isn't Noble Sacrifice, or if it isn't Redemption. But we know that it is Redemption, which puts him in a slightly more awkward spot. He does also still have a natural curve of Totem Golem into Totem Golem from this point, if he wants to go down that line.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Insomnia True Silver Championship 2. My name is Nimsh, and I'm here with Subtle and Noxious. We had some connectivity issues That's why the delay, we are super sorry about it, but we're back now and in the tournament. So guys, let's quickly recap. Noxious, what happened?
Martin Creek was facing off against Elky, who was 2-1 up over him. So it turns out that Secret Paladin may get destroyed by the Shaman left for Martin Creek, but that Shaman will have to be Druid right afterwards, and that's going to be a little bit tricky, I think.
Yeah, definitely will be. He's in a decent spot. He has two reasonable matchups with his one remaining deck, which is Aggro Shaman, but like I said, he is 2-1 down, has to win two games. So the matchup that we're about to go into here is Aggro Shaman versus Secret Paladin. That's where we stand in the matchup before the disconnect issues.
Absolutely. And we're also, like, the whole round is being played at the very moment. So I talked to a lot of players who probably had a chance as well. Tice is playing versus Legendarian. I think Tice is winning 2-1 at the very moment. And Blackout, was Blackout 0-2?
Blackout is 0-2, yeah. He lost both his games. So there's a lot of things splashing around. Obviously, people are frustrated because the whole venue lost internet. It wasn't just this game that we had the issue with. So a lot of players felt they were in strong positions and are now frustrated. And Noxious, straight away, I want to have a conversation with you about this card that we see in Martin Creek's opening hand.
Which yes.
What I was alluding to earlier with the kind of hidden tech in this SK Gaming Aggro Shaman. I know you're a fan of this card as well.
Yeah, I think Illbin's Stalker should make his way, I don't know if it's, I guess his way, not its way, into right. Probably Aggro Druid and Aggro Shaman. It's a really solid 2-drop, and it benefits way too much from cards like Flametongue Totem and, you know, just Abusive Sergeant. If you're willing to use those in Aggro Shaman, which maybe you are, I know a lot of lists don't play Flametongue.
Yeah.
Maybe then you would cut it, but otherwise it's a really solid 2-drop.
That is a hand right there.
Wow. Unbelievable.
Tunnel Trog into Gilbin Stalker into Feral Spirits.
Well, that's
really
a hand too.
Stuff.
Yeah, that's a really good opening there. But for the Paladin, there is Knife Juggler and Master for Battle, which is also a great start. Divine Favor might not work in this matchup.
I mean, I will say one thing though. The earlier, like the game that they're rematching, Martin Creek had an astonishingly good opening hand with the double Flame Juggler, double Totem Golem. I mean, it looks like that strength is still going to carry forward.
Yeah, it's one of the worst things that you can happen to you as a player when you get a disconnect in a position where you feel favored, and you know the rules just say because they're the rules that you pregame. But you know, it looks like Martin Creek has got a very strong start again here, so he won't be feeling too upset about the situation.
So what can you do to come back? Secret Keeper doesn't seem that bad.
I almost like just muster as soon as possible, given the fact that you have Avenge set up, but it is open to something like an Earthshock, just negating every single thing you do. So I wouldn't be surprised if he just opted for the double minion play. Empties the hand a bit.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. There's a lot of options this turn. I think probably just Knife Juggler individually is too weak right now, so I would expect to see some kind of line, either with the Knife Juggler followed up by the Secret Keeper, or as Noxious suggested, the Muster for Battle here, because this at least gives you a platform to fight from for the next turn. You probably feel like you're going to keep something on board to fight with here, but he's going to get the sad news that Feral Spirits is about to come down to back this board up, and the damage is ramping up so quickly already for Martin Creek here.
Yeah, so it seems like Elky will need the Consecration as fast as possible, but he used the coin, so we don't have mana for that. Might be tough, because this Shaman basically just needs to deal as much damage as possible with minions at the very beginning of the game, and is not concerned about the board that much. And then just burst your opponent down with spells coming from turn 4, 5, 6.
Right. And that Totem Golem draw on the previous turn for Martin Creek is actually a really big deal, because it fills out his curve so nicely now, adds more damage still to his Tunnel Trog, and he's just going to be able to keep going face and just ignoring this, this secret that's in play here from Elky, which is going to have no effect on the game at the moment.
Yeah. Right now, I think the Consecration is one of the only things that Elky could pull out of his deck to really help this.
Well, he got Noble Sacrifice, which will work with Secret Keeper and will proc Avenge, because Martin Creek will want to attack, but it's not the best. It's absolutely not winning him this game yet, not to bring him back. But maybe it will give him tools to at least fight back a bit.
Yeah, the problem he's going to run into here is that, yes, he's going to get a nice Avenge buff off the Noble Sacrifice here, but you know, Martin Creek still doesn't really have to interact with the Avenge minion.
Does not care, yes.
Yeah, he's not in a position where he's too bothered about his opponent's board. He's got 8 damage in the opening, and he's about to push a ton more here, so
Makes
a lot of sense.
Perfect answer to that Avenge, given that you deal 3 damage to that Secret Keeper right away.
Right.
And then you can trigger the secret and use the Rockbiter weapon.
I mean, Rockbite is definitely solid here. He's going to have to sequence things correctly in case of Noble Sacrifice, which I'm sure he will. But Rockbiter is a nice option here just to protect his board, but does open him up a little bit to Consecration, which will be a board clear here if he attacks with one of the 2/3s into the Noble Sack.
Right. But would you really expect a Consecration? This is not the card you keep versus Shaman, so he will need to draw into it, and you mostly play one of if ever. Like,
yeah, if that, right.
He knows the Consecration is there because we've seen it before versus Warrior.
Yeah. Yeah, he knows it's in the deck, so it might be something that he considers. But yeah, I think you're absolutely right, Nimsh. When you're playing against Secret Paladin, I feel like you just make them have it. And if they do have their one copy of Consecration, then sure, like, well played.
You're still good, though, because you do have Feral Spirit in this spot, or right. even Totem Golem Hero Power,
right.
forcing the Sword Silver Champion.
Keeper of Ulduman.
Not the best.
Well,
mean, you can still snipe the 2-1, right? If your juggler gets lucky.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. The alternate play is to turn that Tunnel Trog into a 3-3, which doesn't exactly seem ideal.
Because
so.
It keeps the buff, right?
Right.
The ability to buff itself.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
So, I mean, Knife Juggler Hero Power looks like the only line of play here, but it's probably only marginally more successful than Escape Concede right now, so.
Well, that success rate is at 0%,
yeah.
and this is what, 1.5 yeah. perhaps?
Yeah, that's a tough spot to be in. That knife misses.
Not a good knife, and quite a decent top deck again. Looks like the pressure is just going to keep piling up.
Is it lethal with this? Because Lightning Bolt is 4 damage,
and
so it's 10 plus
14,
four.
I believe.
Looks
yeah.
like almost lethal.
Yeah.
Wait, actually, wait. I think he's with the extra 3 from the Bolt.
Yeah, it's 14, right? 10 on board
10
right
on
now.
Board,
and the
yeah,
bolt
and then he's getting an extra 4.
Yeah.
So. Close enough.
Well, if it's not lethal, you can actually use it on the knife.
I
juggler.
Would. I don't. I still. I mean, can you really lose if you push face with everything?
I don't think you. I mean, I don't think you can lose if you knife, if you bolt the juggler. I don't
Either.
Think you can lose if you go face.
Oh no! It does BGH now.
So many decisions.
Right, I mean, it's a decision. You can choose to do either one, but the result is pretty much the same here. Just an incredibly oppressive opening with the Tunnel Trog into Feral Spirits, and that Gilblin Stalker didn't quite get to show his worth. He pretty much would have done the same thing as Flame Juggler or
right.
River Crocolisk in this
drop.
Situation. But
it did deal a lot of damage.
Right, but it, you know, it just functioned as a 2-3, essentially. It wasn't really a big deal, but I do really like that addition. It makes a lot of sense. It's something that we saw a long time ago in Control Priest,
yes.
when it was just a target for Powered Shield, a target for Velen's Chosen, but stealth minions in aggro decks are just something that people have been exploring for a long time. It took a while for example, Worgen Infiltrator to find its way into Face Hunter.
Yeah.
And then people realized how powerful, you know, stealth is essentially delayed charge in a sense.
Exactly, so. Because it's like the second side, like one side is buffing the creature because it's still stealthed
yeah.
and it doesn't die, but the second one is that it actually is not getting removed by your opponent.
Right.
Where normally you would just expect the fireworks to attack your minion. Or something like a Rogue Biter from your opponent.
Yeah, but I mean, the result of that match, I think, was to be expected. After all, Aggro Shaman was almost designed to eat up Secret Paladin when it was first made. The Druid, however, is a bit of a different story.
It is indeed. Things like Harrison Jones can swing this match up intensely, but also just Druid minions against face decks. Obviously, face decks, by their nature, want to be ignoring your minions whenever they can, and Druid minions are just too aggressive, especially when compounded with Savage Roar, that a lot of the time you can't just leave them on the board and race them. So.
Right.
What would you guys say? Is it like, is it 50-50, or would you favor any of those decks?
I think, like, top level, both people playing super optimally, I think Face Shaman has a slight edge,
yeah.
but it's not a huge advantage. And again...
Wow, okay.
I mean, like, okay, Face Shaman hand aside, also look at Elky's hand right now. This is about the nuts from both sides right now, so it'll be really interesting as to how this plays out.
Yeah, I mean, okay. getting the 1-1s out on the board is very important just to neutralize what you know the Shaman is going to be trying to do, but when you look at the Tunnel Trog and the Totem Golem, which is, by the way, especially difficult to remove as a Druid player, given that you have no 4 damage spell, this looks like Martin Creek just has, again, the nuts.
Yeah, like even the fact that... he can play Talent Shock right now and then just go coin Feral Spirit is actually big.
Isn't oh, Flame Juggler? Is that it?
Is this Juggler first? Wow, okay.
Let's do it.
Yeah, the problem with Tunnel Trog there is that you just give your opponent a play on turn 2 if he doesn't have the Wild Growth. Just attack, Hero Power is a fine turn. So I'm a big fan of the Flame Juggler here. You have a 66% chance of a pretty dominant board position, and then you can move forward into your other minions as a follow-up.
Yeah, makes sense. I'm interested to see if this Wild Growth will not be... say too slow in a way. Like he has a follow-up with Keeper of the Grove on turn 4, which will be great, but Martin Krieg is already doing damage this turn.
That Leponome is so clutch, just rounds out his curve really nicely here. Personally, I would like to see Tunnel Trog Leponome here and then trading into the 1-1 to protect your Trog from the on-curve Keeper of the Grove. And then, like, again, you just get that Tunnel Trog Feral Spirits situation. Yeah, that's exactly what we see here.
And you curve into turn four with the Totem Golem, which makes it even worse for the opponent.
Would you ever silence the Tunnel Trog here? It's just too good to kill, I guess.
Interesting decision, maybe, but I feel like too often you end up running into a situation where just that 2-2 on its own will pile up more damage than something can kill later. So
yeah, it makes sense. It's not like he has to have Feral Spirit as the follow-up. But there is Feral Spirit, and is there anything better than Feral Spirit on this turn?
I do not believe so. He again has the Feral Spirit into Totem Golem curve, which is exactly what he had on turn 3 or 4 in the previous game, and you saw how powerful it was then. So yeah, I see no reason to take any risk here, and I don't see any reason to trade with that because it just exposes you.
Well, I like the trade. I like the Lipperno maybe being traded away just because it guarantees a clear with the Wolf.
Sure.
But if there's no Swipe, then that is even stronger, right? Like the play that he made right there.
Absolutely. Swipe would be amazing, but then Sludge Belcher is also something that blocks the attacks at least.
Yeah.
And then he'll have Force of Nature next turn.
Yeah. Let's just put it that way. Elky is under the gun.
Yeah.
Pretty rough.
He certainly is. Yeah, Belcher going to come down here. I think Elky was probably considering whether he needed to hero power this turn to start reducing some of these minions on the board, because with that board left up, that Sludge Belcher does not really represent a particularly big wall.
Well, another good outcome for Martin Creek. He draws the Lightning Bolt. So by using these two one-cost spells, he can not only buff the Trog, but also clear out the Belcher.
Yeah, it's probably better than just going for Totem Golem. Just Rockbiter the 2-1. Maybe even like a Lepronome to be able to get that damage from the Death Rattle.
I think the important thing here is as well, based on that previous turn from Elky, Martin Creek knows that there's no removal in hand for that Tunnel Trog, because if there was, that Tunnel Trog would have gone down that turn 100%.
Yes.
So what he can do with that information is now just leverage these cards in his hand to protect that Tunnel Trog and keep it beating away every single turn.
Yep, that's absolutely true. And that Tunnel Trog has to connect to face this turn. Which wolf do you use? Or do you even use a wolf? Or do you keep the... Do you use the Rockbiter here?
Yeah, he used the Rockbiter to clear out the 2-2, quite possibly. I mean, he doesn't have Doomhammer in hand. Even if he did draw Doomhammer, he couldn't play it next turn. So I think protecting that 2-2 is definitely a valid consideration. Looks like, yeah, he's going to go ahead and do it.
Yeah, it makes sense. I mean, if there was a Swipe to kill the wolf that you didn't trade away, you would have seen it.
Right, and this representation of fighting for the board is all based on that turn that we saw previously, where Martin Creek has this read now that there's no removal in hand, so I can win this game on the board and remove my opponent's minions.
Right.
Suddenly, Wrath appears. A great card to deal with the Trog. He wasn't even able to deal with the Trog with the Force of Nature on that turn.
No, the Wolves just prove a bit too much health. So there was a consideration there, obviously, for the hero power to kill the Wolf instead. But that buys you way too little in terms of late game, continued tempo, I guess.
Yeah, he now has a position with this guaranteed minion on board. Again, we talk about the power of stealth being a reliable source of an attack. He can use this in combination with, say, Force of Nature in his hand to set this up really nicely, but Ancient of War might just be enough to tempt him away from that play.
That's tough. But
I still like getting rid of the board first before playing it just to protect it, but if you do that, you might end up in the point where, if damage is pushed at your face again this turn, suddenly Ancient of War doesn't do anything because you just get double lava bursted in the face or something. So you may feel the need to taunt right now.
And there is a spell damage totem just waiting on board as well. So a tough spot for Elky, definitely.
Yeah, there's a possible lethal off of a high crackle roll if the spell damage totem stays alive.
Yep.
Well, it seems that it will actually stay alive.
It should, yes, definitely.
Even if you Force of Nature, you basically want to clear this board, so you'll attack into one of the Feral Spirits and then kill Feral and the 3-4.
All right, forcing his opponent to have the Earth Shock or the tremendous amount of damaging spells.
Well, there is a lot of damage in hand at the very moment.
Yeah.
Just
Piloted Shredder as well. Sorry, Nimsh, to cut you off.
Like
Piloted Shredder in Aggro Shaman is a very, very interesting inclusion.
Yeah. Yeah, it is a bit of a different build. Would you think there is a Flametomb Totem as well?
It seems reasonable, right? Pilot Shredder, extra targets on the board, Gilblin Stalker, that stealth effect. It seems to be this would have Abusive Sergeants and Flametomb Totem in the
Sky Golem. We saw the Pilot Sky Golem earlier as well.
Right.
Giving him a little bit of extra damage in the late game. I mean, it tends to do pretty well to fight off against some of those late game legendaries that some people put in.
I think Martin Creek's just trying to get full value out of those GVG minions before they disappear.
No, I'll never get to play you again.
Yeah, well. I was like, wait, they're removing Shredder? I'm going to put it in every deck until that happens.
Yeah, poor Crackle.
Is he thinking about Crackle now?
Thinking, can I 25% this like a god?
I mean, it's a serious.
I like it because worst case scenario, you play Lava Burst on the 5/10 and you still get a win. Nope.
Miss.
That is not a good outcome. It's actually one of the saddest because now everything has to go to the 5/10. I wouldn't be surprised to see a very slow play here from Martin Creek until he top decks that lethal.
Right, but it really was a serious consideration as to whether you wanted to go for it that turn, because as soon as you commit to that Crackle to find out if you had lethal, that was your whole turn gone.
Right.
You couldn't do anything else with your turn. So he had to think about how much he valued that Piloted Shredder on the board, which I guess when faced with a 5/10 taunt, the answer is not very much, and he's just decided it's time to burn face here and see what happens.
And now it's a big chance for Elky. Martin Creek has the 5 damage in hand with the Lava Burst, but the board is pretty much cleared. So if Elky is able to just increase his health total, and with the shapeshift, he will be.
Yeah, now one of the things that's funny here is that Elky is obviously choosing to go face with that 5 damage, knowing full well that a 5/10 will not be an issue. But what I have to wonder, though, is like how afraid is he of Earthshock at this point?
Ooh, Ancestral Knowledge through the cards.
Yeah, Ancestral Knowledge is going to be a little bit slow for this turn. I'm not sure if he can pick up lethal to go with the Lava Burst with enough mana left over. There's no one mana card that's going to do the
Lava Shock, maybe, possibly?
Well, he still wouldn't have enough.
Still
mana.
Not enough mana. Yes.
No, it wouldn't be enough, but he's able to like dig through his deck and pick up stack up the damage for the following turn. Still has a couple of turns left to live based on what he can see from the Druid side here, so he just needs to assemble critical mass of burn in his hand here. Ancestral Knowledge, a great card to start doing that.
This is really interesting because if he rolls the spell damage totem next turn, he will have 10 damage.
Right.
And then Elky will be at 11. So maybe Flame Juggler will decide who wins or who loses.
Very possible. He may even be considering lightning bolting the Shade of Necromancer here just to potentially slow down his opponent's clock for one turn and give him more chances to draw more burn. It's one of those kind of difficult calculations when you're playing aggro. Like, can I spend damage to give myself more time to draw more damage?
I mean, I don't dislike this play. If the one damage goes phase, then that's a really big deal. This, however, is not the most meaningful. I mean, it does mean that it doesn't trade up with a 2/3.
Right.
Yeah.
So that's something positive, at least.
Martin Creek is thinking about the combo. If there will be a Force of Nature Savager, he will be dead. But he's seen one force already.
You don't really have the choice either way, right?
Okay, now Elky.
Wants to armor up.
Would you really expect a 10 damage burst?
Yes. Coming from Shaman? Yes. Yeah, I mean, every day.
It's double Lava Burst, right? It's a real thing that you play around. 10 is a number they can deal. They have two Lava Bursts in their deck. So 11 does suddenly start demanding more cards than just to double Lava Burst.
Or like even a Lightning Bolt, Lava Shock, and Lava Burst, right?
Right.
Like,
exactly.
There's a big combination. And Shaman damage is just so easy to find nowadays.
Yep.
So it's just a matter of deciding whether or not you value that extra 2/4. And that's basically, it comes down to, do I set up lethal if I develop it, right?
Yeah, and it's actually a difficult turn because he wants to push face to set up his own lethal for the following turn, but he doesn't respect these totems, then his opponent has a 50-50 chance of rolling spell damage now.
Exactly. And Flame Tongue is no help for now, given that there are no charge minions to go with this.
We have confirmed that it's in the deck now, though.
Right.
We suspected it is in there, so that's good information to have if we see Martin Creek later on after this game.
And again, same problem as earlier. Now Martin Creek has to decide what he wants to do with this mana. There's really no choice but to go with the totem roll. But you could use your spells to remove the board.
Yeah, I think like you definitely need to remove the shade this turn at least.
If you roll a totem, then you don't, because you win, right?
No, you don't. Almost. Because there's not suddenly you're one
damage away. Yeah.
I mean, while we were talking about what combination of cards do 10 damage in Face Shaman, Spell Power Totem, Lava Burst, Lightning Bolt does it as well. So.
Yeah, exactly. That's why he needed the Flame Juggler to hit face before.
Right.
So Flame Tongue, I mean, that gives you just enough that you can start using your spells and remove most of this.
Yeah, it looks like he's going to have to go like Lava Burst, the Ancient of War, throw away a lot of his damage here, but it does open up good trades on the board, leaves just the Drake behind, but now having committed that Lava Burst, he has to find some serious
I don't think
way
he can afford, yeah, he can't afford losing this board. Oh, goodness. All right, Elky's actually looking pretty strong right now, if he can just dodge.
Just get Ancient of War!
Oh, there we go. Well, health problems.
Five more health, and you can actually get rid of the Flametongue Totem.
Nah, Elky's a baller. He's going to draw cards.
That's it. He's like, I'm all in, shove. Yeah. There's nothing else to do.
Yep.
Is he bluffing with the card, one card in hand?
What could that be? Everybody knows it's Grand Crusader. He's going to give Avenging Wrath. Everybody knows it.
It can be Argent Horse Rider, four damage to face.
That's right. And then what?
What about double? It's enough now.
Yeah, right now Elky like would be hard pressed to lose this. One of the few things that could really punish him is if somehow Elky plays Elemental Destruction and finds Lava Shock. Like, let's just say a silly situation where he picks up Ancestral Knowledge into Elemental Destruction into Lava Shock.
Yeah.
And then somehow top decks the win with there's some kind of Doomhammer.
I wonder if he does though with this specific build, whether he tried to fight for board control.
I'd be surprised.
Flame Control him and fight
I'd be control. Very surprised.
Yeah. So now suddenly you have to go for 14
Ouch.
Points of health, and you can't even cast both of the cards at the same time, despite that Shredder's just sitting in his hand.
Yeah, it really just hasn't found a time for it. I mean, I can definitely see situations where Shredder is useful, but there's a lot of matchups where come turn four, okay, come being able to spend four mana, which in this deck quite often doesn't happen until turn five or six, you're in the situation where you just want to push face all the time anyway.
Yeah.
This is obviously a more board-focused deck that the SK people like, feel like has strong matchups in what they're expecting in this tournament, but still, that Pilot Shredder, as you said, he's been punished for it here, because if it was a more aggressive card or another source of burn, then he may have just had that critical massive damage in his hand at some point during
the game.
Well,
honestly, it comes back to the turn where he decided to go for the Crackle kill, if
right.
possible,
right.
instead of playing the Shredder.
Yes, exactly,
then.
Yeah.
So he felt the blood, and because he was unfortunate with the roll, he got punished for the greedy play. But then, high risk, high reward. Like, if he crackles and wins, he just wins, and that's it.
Yep. That makes a lot of sense, but Elky is just slowly lengthening his foothold in this game. He's slightly unfortunate from his side that he hasn't drawn exactly that card.
For the entire game,
yeah,
right, exactly.
So many times it would have just pretty much ended the game or just represented enough damage to just push him over the line and allowed him to be more aggressive. But spending a pretty useless Innovate here at this point just to gain one life, take out a totem here. But this game is all over bar the shouting right now.
Unless Elemental Destruction, which is unlikely. You can also... No, I can't.
That will not help.
I was thinking if there is a way to like get a Doomsayer from your own Shredder.
You lightning bolt your own Shredder?
No,
there's no more of them.
It will not work.
Yeah, Martin Creek throws out the well played, and Elky is going to take a very impressive win over a really solid European player representative of SK Gaming. So, you know, Elky's rise through the ranks of Hearthstone continues. He's looking like he can be a very promising player in the future if he keeps working at it.
Absolutely. I think Elky has a good chance to get to the top 8, top 16 today. Because he is at the moment 2-0 versus good opponents, so he will have a good tiebreaker overall.
We got a bye in round one, so.
Yeah, the bye was for Elky, I believe.
This means like he has a 100% win rate versus good opponents.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Versus good. Bye is a hell of a Hearthstone player, I've heard him.
That guy is sick.
Yeah.
But I think bye actually gives you a good tiebreaker overall.
Yeah. I mean, I'm actually pretty sure that bye has a 0% win rate in tournaments.
So, zero?
Yeah.
Oh, it's sometimes better than most of the players you can play against.
Wow.
That is harsh.
Wow.
Give me a name.
Nimsh with the BM.
I want a name. I want the Strother. Give me one name you think Bai can beat.
Well, there's a lot of local players that will be 0-3.
That is right.
So or even they will continue playing, which is even worse. Because it happens sometimes.
No.
You have this one guy.
Evil.
You lose versus this one guy in the Swiss tournament, and he just continue playing, and he goes like 0-6. And then you look at the end of the day, you're like 5-2. And do I make top 16?
It's like Team Celestial in Archon Team League, right?
Yeah, you go
kind of like the same thing.
Full Team Celestial, and like you check your tiebreaker, and you're like, why am I the worst 5-2 in the whole tournament?
Goodness gracious.
So much BM to these fine casual players here at Insomnia Gaming Festival.
I don't like
I personally am glad for my UK compatriots who have turned up to have some fun, entered the Hearthstone tournament.
Right.
Absolutely.
You guys keep doing you. Don't listen to Nimsh. Nimsh is just mean.
They're not my compatriots, but I still like them.
I have nothing against having fun and playing at the tournament. That's why we have the Swiss, which is an open Swiss. Everybody
right.
can play, everybody can have fun and
right.
play versus the world champion, European champion. But then definitely if the European champion, the world champion, if they lose, or they play versus casuals, they would love the casuals to continue winning
right.
because of the
tiebreaker. Right. Yeah, of course.
Okay, so, well, that was the match. Martin Creek is not out, obviously, because the second round of the Swiss tournament, he is 1-1 at the very moment. Losing versus Elky, no shame there, obviously. And Elky, if he continues winning, this will also boost Martin Creek's tiebreaker overall.
Right.
So just to remind you guys, $30,000 prize pool. Today we have the Swiss rounds. We have seven of them, seven Swiss rounds overall. And then 16 players will advance to day two. What happens on day two, Noxious?
We'll have the top 16 trying to call in double elimination format down to a very small top eight, right, for the last day that we'll be casting. So it'll be pretty intense to see who gets there. I mean, the Swiss is not a format that you see a lot of, I guess, in the tournament scene, but it is one that I love. Aside from the broadcasting side of things, which a lot of people kind of think makes Swiss unwatchable, mm-hmm. As far as the competitive value of it or the merits of it, I think that's just a crazy edge that we have.
Absolutely. And the format is Last Hero Standing, as
right.
mentioned. So a really cool format overall, and a different one than Conquest.
Yeah, something that we haven't seen for a while, and it's good to see it coming back. I personally would have loved there to be a ban in this tournament. I think that opens up so much more depth to the Last Hero Standing thing. But yeah, it just, you know, Hearthstone is a game of many formats right now, and people are duking it out, trying to decide what the best format is, not only in, you know, Last Hero Standing versus Conquest versus all these other weird formats, but also in, you know, tournament makeup, right? Swiss versus groups versus double elim versus single elim. So we're still trying to find out what the tournament format is. We'll get there at some point, but until
Absolutely.
Then, experimentation is just good for variety.
Well, we are right. having everything here.
That's very Swiss,
yeah, double, yeah. single elimination, yeah. all the elimination.
It's just like a buffet of Hearthstone formats.
Absolutely.
Yeah. No bans.
No bans.
No bans. All right, guys, so that was round two. I think some matches are being finished at the very moment, but we'll not have any more matches for you with the round two. We're going to a short break, prepare the players for round three, and then select a match for you. So stay tuned for more Hearthstone action.